Souls and mixing martinis in our Shady and Shaky show. Joining me are a shady lady, Victoria Coren Mitchell. The Shadow Minister of Mirth, Eshaan Akbar. The Shake of Shenanigans, John Barrowman. And shaking it all about, it's Alan Davis. Hey. Right, let's hear their Shady Shaky signature tunes. Victoria goes. Eshaan goes.
The shadow of your smile.
Nice. Really nice.
Oh, be careful, Eshaan, you'll pull. John goes. It comes to life.
Perfect.
And Alan goes. When you put your left arm in, right. Name something that was invented in either Shaky Town or Shady Town.
I mean, I'm hoping this is a Shaken Stevens question.
Oh!
Because I know a lot about him.
Why?
Because I was a big fan of him as a child. And you know the stuff you learn... Well, child, as a teenager.
It's inexcusable.
It's not inexcusable. He was a... Let me tell you. Tomorrow is Shaken Stevens' 73rd birthday.
No.
And I still would. Because...
Yes.
Not only...
Yeah.
Is he gorgeous? But when you're young, those kind of things go in. I know his birthday, favourite colour, indigo, real name, Michael Barrett, stage name, taken from his old school friend, Stephen van der Valk. He took the name.
Can I just say, I've no idea how we got here. That's all I wanted to get to seismology and geology.
Is it something to do with a Shaky Town, something to do with, like, an earthquake machine?
That's exactly right. So, modern seismology began in Comrie Village, so it's in Perthshire. It's your part of the world, isn't it?
Up in Scotland.
Scotland, yeah.
An earthquake machine in Scotland?
Yes, it's known as Shaky Toon. How was that?
Very good. That was brilliant.
Shaky Toon. So, an incredible number of earthquakes, which you maybe wouldn't even think of in Scotland. The late 18th to the mid-19th century, thousands of earthquakes. There is a thing called the Highland Boundary Fault, and the position of this town is astride the fault. And it still records more and stronger tremors than anywhere else in Britain. It is officially Britain's shakiest town. And so they wanted to measure it, and it's the very first purpose-built seismology station in the world, known as Earthquake House. It's basically a hut in a field, if I'm honest with you.
It looks like a public toilet.
I know. It's so British. Look what we've made.
How about you open the door, yeah, and you can see to the core of the earth.
It was instigated by the Comrie pioneers, basically the local postmaster. He devised one of the earliest measures for earthquakes. So a 10 was a quake that they had in October of 1839, which was felt over most of Scotland.
Oh, that's when the teapot rattles.
Yeah. So the Comrie scale is different scales of quake. So number 10, massive quake in 1839. And then number one I like is called Just Sensible.
What?
Be, yeah, just capable of being sensed.
It's a quiver.
Oh.
It's more of a... Ooh, we've all had those.
That's a different kind of earthquake.
Is that it, yeah. So, incredibly simple mechanism. You get two wooden beams. You get one going north and south and one going east and west like that with wooden cylinders of various sizes on top. And it took various sizes of quake to get the cylinders to fall off. It's not very complicated. And then Sod's Law stepped in. They built the earthquake house. And that coincided pretty much with the end of the great era of earthquakes in Comrie.
The earthquake, it just moved on.
Yeah.
They built something.
What happened to the postman?
He is remembered for having done this. Not so remembered that I can tell you what his name was.
I reckon he invented it to explain why whenever he delivered things, it was always broken in the box.
Yes. But we now realise that this hut is of historic significance, and they've, in fact, updated it with modern equipment so sensitive it picked up the tsunami on Boxing Day 2004 in Indonesia. So that is
extraordinary. No way. Yeah. So it wasn't related to the Richter scale?
Yeah, is that different?
Yes, the Richter scale is entirely different, yeah. So this was the first measure that we had. Right, so we've done Shaky Toon. Let's go to Shady Town. It's, I can tell you, also in Scotland. Any thoughts?
A place where the sun never shines?
Yes, darling, it is. Locranza on Arran. It is the UK's, possibly the world's, shadiest town. It gets fewer annual hours of sunshine than anywhere else because it sits on a sort of north-facing glen on a rainy island. It has no streetlights. I have to say, I've been there, and it is extremely beautiful. But it is also the birthplace of modern geology. So we've got two places in Scotland that have done wonders for the study of the planet. The man is known as the father of modern geology, James Hutton. He visited in 1787. And he discovered, it was the very first example of what's called Hutton's unconformity. And I love this because I notice it and don't know what it is, but it's a junction between different types of rock formation. Mm. And he developed the idea that such formations could only have resulted over unimaginable time, so the Earth could not be young, as the Bible claimed. So I think we can just show you with some writing on the top. Can you see how you've got the ones that are the structures that are going up like that? And isn't it incredible? So he supported what was called Plutonism, which is that rocks are formed by volcanic action, against Neptunism, that rocks were formed by the biblical flood. It's stunningly beautiful, I think, the way the Earth has shifted and moved like that. It's wonderful. Anyway, he wrote a line in a 1788 paper which has, well, it's echoed through geological science ever since. The result, therefore, of our present inquiry is that we find no vestige of a beginning, no prospect of an end. It's really lovely. Modern seismology and geology were invented 60 miles from each other in Scotland. Describe the dark side of puppeteering.
Well, surely it's everything that goes on underneath.
Below the desk.
That's the way to do it.
Thank
Alan, stop playing with your puppet under the table.
What do all the other puppets do when you put them down?
Specific kind of puppetry that we're thinking of, the dark side of puppetry. Any thoughts?
Shadows?
What about Hank Marvin? Would you or wouldn't you?
I tell you what, Cliff Richard, I definitely would. Don't say anything. I would.
Talking about a specific type of shadow puppetry, I've got some examples here. So it's Java, Indonesia, Asia. It's a 1,000-year-old form of a shadow puppet theatre called a wayang. So they often tell Hindu epics. The only thing is, the shows can last 8 or more hours, right?
Of course they can. I mean, if it's in a Bollywood film, they last 16 days.
Yes, exactly that.
I mean, all puppet shows feel like they've lasted 8 or 9 hours.
The ninth hour of the Punch of Judy.
Unfortunately, it is a skill which is very slightly dying out, so some of the puppeteers have taken to performing Star Wars-themed shows, for example, to younger audiences, and they take some liberties. So then we've got Chewbacca and Han Solo.
I am all for that.
You think that's okay?
Love it. Still have my original Star Wars toys. I have a whole section of the garage devoted to Star Wars memorabilia. I even have my Star Wars pajama, you know, pants. And I go to... Don't laugh at me! I go to bed dressed.
Where else is he going to keep his lightsaber at night?
I mean,
massive Star Wars fan. I love that. I think that's a great idea.
Do you only have the trousers?
No, I have the top bit too, but it's like I have one that's Darth Vader pants, and then on the top it says, "I'm your daddy."
That is just so wrong.
I've never watched Star Wars.
Did you want to confess anything while we're doing this, like turning it into therapy?
Well, yeah, maybe. I don't know.
I think Star Wars is a confession
in
itself.
That is quite a big. Alan, did you have anything you wanted to reveal to the rest of the world?
Oh,
actually, I asked you this once and you told me you'd pooed on Hampstead Heath or something.
Oh, yes. That's right, and I'm not falling into this trap again.
Huh? Lovely. Anyway, they're now using Wayang shows, which is what this puppetry is, to explain all sorts of things. They've used it for COVID-19. They use it for the destruction of coral reefs. I mean, all sorts of kind of educational stuff. It's quite complex, and traditionally, there's just one puppet master who's called a Dalang, and they are highly respected, and it used to be that Indonesian children wanted to grow up and be a Dalang. Oh. Usually boys would work the puppets and girls play the genda, which is a bit like a glockenspiel. And the puppets, as you can see, are really intricate. And perversely, considering they're there to create shadows, they're very brightly painted.
Yeah, that is odd, isn't it?
Yes, this is just a curiosity. I've got ready.
This is a move. Yas, queen! Yas, queen! Yas! Yas, queen! Yas, yas, yas! Yas, queen!
What's that thing called, darling? Is it called a GIF or whatever it is, where you... TikTok thing.
You cluck.
And, yeah. Could I say something and then you just stand behind me going, yas, queen!
Yas, queen!
I love that.
I'll do a soundbite for you. You can use it.
Yes, please. I'd like that very much.
I really enjoyed the talk about social media there. That was cute. That was
I genuinely have no idea what I just...
Can I do a GIF on TikTok? No, you can't, but yeah.
I don't do any of it. Do you do it, darling? You do all that social...
No.
No.
It's a dancing thing.
You could do a musical thing which is like wood, wouldn't, wood, wood, wouldn't, wood.
Tell me you want to sleep with Shaky Stevens without telling me you want to sleep with Shaky Stevens.
And the puppeteer, it's improv. They improvise most of the play.
So they come out and say, so can someone give me an object? An object situation. Then let's have a feeling. Let's have an emotion.
Unusual occupation. Yeah. Let's go for that.
Gynecologist! Yeah.
Can I tell you this about when I first took my daughter to a puppet show? I found this very, very annoying. The puppeteer came out and, you know, had the puppets and spoke to the audience. And I wanted to say, look, fine. After the age of about 30, magnificent, break it down, deconstruct it. My child is 3. She thinks it's... Just bring it up behind a hay bale.
It's fine.
let it be a talking creature. I used to watch Rainbow, and if you remember that show, I was 15 before I wondered why Zippy was always behind something. He's behind a bush. Oh, they're in the kitchen. He's behind the washing machine. Never ask the question.
Have you ever worked with the Muppets?
I have.
Yeah, because it's amazing to be, like, with Kermit or Miss Piggy or anyone. It's very difficult not to reference them if you don't.
But Kermit's the weirdest one, because it's, like, on his head. It's on his head, and then he's working the hands like that.
I still would.
Of course.
Shall we see if we can revive a traditional shadow puppet art form ourselves? Shadowgraphy is the art of making shadow shapes with your hands. I'll just show you the sort of shapes that we're looking for, OK? So there's a wolf and there's a goat and there's a swan and a rabbit, OK? Yeah. And I want you to see if you can recreate those. So you two go behind the screen and you two try and guess which ones that they are doing.
Oh, don't go behind the screen and then what's going to happen?
I know, you never know. Right. OK.
Eshaan, you've got such tiny hands. Oh, look
at that! I beg your pardon!
Right, that's... I don't know, what do you think Eshaan's doing?
Is it a jellyfish?
I don't know.
Eshaan's telling us where to go, I think.
It's something...
Is that right?
It's a frog with an enormous vulva.
Is it a rabbit? Is it a squirrel?
What is that?
Being attacked!
That's Rod Holland Emu.
You've got a swan with a hand coming out his ass. What is this? The thumb is not working for me.
What do you mean the swan isn't working for you?
Well, make it speak or eat or something. So there we go. Well done. Let's have a go at you two having a go. Off you go, around the screen.
Luckily, I'm known for my knockabout physical comedy.
I can't wait to see this.
I can't believe Alan said I've got small hands.
Darling, it's perspective.
It's not the size.
Yes, exactly. Thank you.
OK, here we go. Alan's doing a spider.
It looks like a duck?
Oh, a fox. Victoria's very good. That's very good. I literally don't know.
I don't know what my
Alan's.
Oh, hang on a minute. It's a bit more bent. And as for the fingers...
Yeah. Alan looks like a tapeworm.
Yeah. What is that?
Exploding out of John Hurt's... It's a goat.
It's a goat.
It's well, a goat.
Very yeah. well done.
Yeah. Goat.
Who knew that you had wolf in you?
I think I've made that perfectly clear.
Now, what's shady and two-dimensional about this guy? So, if I give you his name, it may help. He was the French Minister of Finance for just 8 months under Louis the 15th, and he was called Étienne de Silhouette.
Is no. that why Silhouette... Was he thought of as a shadowy figure?
It's why shadow portraits, you know the portraits where you just get
yes.
the sort of outline of a person done
yes.
in black?
Yes.
They're known as silhouettes, and it is because his, well, the normal explanation, his austerity policies, which eventually got him fired, caused his name to be associated with sort of general thriftiness. And these were cheaper portraits for people oh. who couldn't afford to have oil portraits. I think they're very beautiful, but it's not for me to say. We have an expert with us. Please welcome master silhouettist Charles Burns. There he is. Charles, tell me, how did you learn to be a silhouettist? How did that happen?
When I left art college, I worked for a number of years as a street portrait artist in Covent Garden and drawing portraits originally, and then I started cutting silhouettes more or less as a sideline, but they completely took over my life.
They became very popular in Europe and they came over, didn't they, from France?
They did. They became very popular throughout the 18th and early 19th centuries, but they died out, really, when photography was invented and all the silhouette artists went out of business.
Which I think is a great shame. In fact, studios used to be equipped sometimes with a physionotrace?
A physionotrace is the word you're looking for, yes. The physionotrace was like an arm, like a metal bar, which used to be passed around someone's profile. And at the other end of the bar was a little pencil, which on a small piece of paper would draw upside down and in reverse their profile.
But you don't do anything as...
No, I rely entirely on a pair of scissors.
Pair of scissors
and a technique I call cut and hope.
OK, I like that. So you're going to do our silhouettes while we're carrying on chatting. So can I get
yes.
you to sit and carry on?
I shall go and
cutting,
explore
cutting
your
away. Oh, OK. Imagine you're on a coin. While he's cutting away, I can tell you there was even an automaton called Prosopographus. So prosopon is Greek for face. And it was set up in the 1820s on the Strand in London by a silhouette artist called Charles Hervé. And it was a sort of small robotic figure sitting on a box with a tablet in one hand and a stylus on the other. And it drew an outline of your face, which could then be cut into a silhouette. We have no idea how the automaton worked, although some visitors reported seeing human eyes behind the curtain. So we are assuming there was a human inside. Have a quick look at this and tell me what you see here.
Two faces looking at each other.
Two faces looking at each other?
I can see both. I see two faces
right.
or a vase.
Or a vase. What do you see, Victoria?
Shaken Stephen.
A sort of goblet or two people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is, in fact, known as a Rubin's vase. Some Danish psychologist, Edgar Rubin, 1915. And it's very interesting how the brain decides what is an object and what is the background. Mm. So an object sometimes has a sharper colour, there are visual clues, maybe it's closer or it gives you an emotional response. If you remove all of those things, the brain cannot consistently distinguish the object from the background. So right. depending on how we look at it, might think it's a face immediately, might think it's a vase immediately.
Really?
Yeah. There are two British artists, Tim Noble and Sue Webster. They developed a technique and they create silhouettes from heaps of junk. They started their work in 1997. This is one of their pieces that was at the Royal Academy. So that's just junk. It's old wood and rusty tools and toilet roll and all sorts of things. And that's them in silhouette.
That is amazing.
I think it's one of the best things I've ever seen.
People are so creative. I mean, as an Asian kid growing up, imagine if I told my dad, Dad, I want to do stuff with rubbish and make silhouettes.
Yeah. Yeah.
What are you talking about? Just go on QI.
Yeah, exactly. Don't even need to make silhouettes. Although tonight we can make rubbish and silhouettes because I think Charles has finished. Darling, are you going to reveal for us?
I can reveal for you, yes.
All right, so we'll have Victoria first.
OK, there she is.
There we are, there you are.
Oh. Wow.
Oh,
clever. Yeah, amazing.
Just take a couple of inches off the nose. Just bring
Right, should we do Alan?
Oh, oh wow. Oh,
yes.
That's great. Well,
oh, that's very good. Look at the little hair detail at the top.
Yeah, yeah. It's amazing. It's very clever.
Yeah. Eshaan?
As long as I don't look like Romish in this one.
Right.
I look so much older.
The glasses are so brilliant.
Yeah,
yeah, the glasses
That's
are
so clever. Right, Johnny, let's try you, darling. Oh, oh you handsome devil.
So handsome. Yeah,
that's brilliant.
You're so handsome, even lovely. As a cutout.
Wow, I think those are brilliant.
So clever. You're literally just doing that with a pair of scissors.
Yes, I
have. That's amazing.
Yes. A freehand cut with scissors.
I can't even cut a straight line on wrapping paper.
Straight lines are much harder.
I think you're a secret Doctor Who. You've got the coat, you've got the look, you're a secret doctor.
Yeah. Now, this contains everything I need.
See? Yeah.
Charles, it's been such a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's awesome.
Right. What's a McKinley grip?
Ooh.
Ooh.
So the whole show is shade and shake.
A shaky grip.
A shaky grip?
Well, shaky grip, yeah.
So what do? We shake parts of our body, we shake.
The only McKinley that I know is William McKinley, the President of the United States.
Absolutely right, is the McKinley grip, yeah.
He was assassinated.
Yes, he was, yeah.
I don't know if he was a Mason or whatever, but I know he's a Republican. So there might have been a secret handshake?
It wasn't a secret. It was that he was fantastically good at shaking hands. There was a tradition throughout the 19th century in the United States that if anybody wanted to, they could turn up at the White House on New Year's Day and shake the president's hand. And President McKinley was in office 1897 to 1901. He was an enthusiastic handshaker, said to have once shaken 5,000 hands in a single session, but it had to be quick, so he developed something called the McKinley grip. What you do is you give a beaming smile, you grab somebody's hand before they have a chance to take yours, you give it a swift squeeze, in your other hand you take hold of the elbow and push them away.
Oh, yeah.
This was the McKinley grip. Just get rid of them like
what
that.
What a metaphor for all social interaction.
I know, isn't it?
Hysterical.
Come here, go away.
But you're quite right. He was engaged in just such a thing when he was murdered. September the 6th, 1901, he was in Buffalo, New York at the Pan American Exposition when an anarchist called Leon Czolgosz turned up and he had his right hand covered with a handkerchief and the president thought he had some injury or other. But in fact, he shot him point blank. He died of infection about 8 days later. Now, here's the thing. We shake hands. We also shake heads. I think we've said this before on this show, Alan. Some countries, like Bulgaria, they shake for yes and nod for no. So we're going to try a little experiment. I'm going to ask you a series of quick-fire questions with yes or no answers, right? You have to answer immediately, but whatever answer you give with your voice, you have to give the opposite with your head.
Oh.
OK? And I'll ping my pinger if you get it wrong. Does everybody understand?
You pinging your pinger?
No, I'm just asking.
Yes, I do.
Yes.
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 I'm trying to catch you out, that's
yes.
all. OK, all right, ready. John. Was the first James Bond film the one about the Doctor?
Yes.
I don't know. That's right.
Is it right?
Yes. What was the name Doctor... of the Doctor?
No.
Eshaan, do you know what band featured the keyboard player Rick Wakeman?
No.
Don't know?
No. No.
Okay.
But it's yes.
The band is called Yes.
Yes but, is the band.
But you didn't know.
I no.
This would be a great drinking game.
Very
Victoria, do you know what it means when you nod?
Do you know what it means when you nod? Yes, I know what it means. Or, yes, I know what it means.
Alan, have you stopped kicking the dog?
Yes, I never kicked the dog.
Yeah, it's quite complicated. It's quite weird.
Yes.
Nobody knows why the Bulgarians do it the other way around. So, there's a folk tale that they were forced to change their religion by invaders, and so they pretended no meant yes when they were interrogated about their faith. It's a bit like crossing your fingers when you tell
That's
a lie.
Great.
So.
I did a movie in Bulgaria. I was diving in the movie, and that was part of the reason I also got the movie, because I'm a registered diver. They said I had to go in this big tank, and I was given a small canister with oxygen in it. I would breathe, put the oxygen away, then escape from the tank. But I went down, and I said to the guy, is it unlocked? And he went, yes. I'm like, I'm not going down. And he's like, is it locked? Yes, it is.
What was the film, darling?
Oh, you don't want to know.
No, I really want to see it.
It's called Shark Attack 3 Megalodon.
Oh, my.
All I'll say is it bought me my first place.
There's an even more apparently ambiguous is the head bobble. So this is a form of non-verbal communication. It's commonly found in India, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. So according to...
Hi, guys.
Yeah. I'm looking at John. According to a behaviourist from Tamil Nadu, Pradeep Chakravarti, it may have evolved to give a deliberately ambiguous signal. So it's a sort of you can disagree with somebody while not saying anything. That's the head bobble?
It means yes, no, maybe means everything, really. Okay. They do it in Bangladesh as well.
Right. But you're being non-committal, is that it?
Yeah, and you're...
Just do it now.
The move is more from the chin, actually, right. So it's just a...
Yes, queen.
But, yeah, because my parents would use it as well with me every time. When I was like, oh, Mum, can I go out with my friends? She'd be like, yeah, no. Maybe.
Yeah. I went to India one time and lots of people did that. And it's something that's very non-confrontational is what it's a sort of diffusing thing.
I quite like it.
I mean, the last time I was on, I talked about Bollywood dancing. I'm doing it again. Mm. But this neck move is very clearly kind of like a no, isn't it? I mean, you know it's a no. Mm.
Well, but in the gay world, we disagree with that. It's like, get over here.
Great.
Yes, queen.
Yes. No.
Is there any gesture that isn't that?
I'll do gay Bollywood.
You do gay Bollywood. the head bobble. Yeah, the head bobble is from the chin, I think.
From the chin.
It's really hard.
That's pretty good, actually, Alan. That's a good one.
It's a very relaxed thing.
No, really not.
I mean, I look like I'm trying to decide which kind of herring to have for dinner. That's really nice. Right. Here's a pretty shady way to carry on. What's the best way to sabotage a sewage system?
Shadow of your smile.
Begins with S, I'm going to say.
S?
Yes.
Oh, shit. I was going to say... Let me... Yeah!
Shit!
I was not going to say that. There you go.
What were you going to say?
Similar to that, let me have a drunken kebab.
Right, and that would be the way forward.
That would, yeah.
Have you ever been sabotaged?
No.
Anything ever happened to you? Speaking of shit, and you've pooped in Hampstead Heath. No.
It's well known.
How is this still coming up?
This was a number of years ago now. Oh, it's still there.
Yeah.
Mm. Since lockdown, most of Hampstead's gone at least once on the heath.
Yeah, that's
since
true.
Since they
that's
shut all the toilets.
That's true. It's now called wild toileting.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, I was doing a show in Nashville, Tennessee, where I was dressed in white polyester. It was in the 80s, and I was
to qualify.
To qualify, you know. And I was doing a number I called I Got Rhythm, and I felt like a little rumble in my tummy, and I thought, I'm just going to fart. And I just felt heat. Heat in my polyester white pants.
Oh.
Well, I kept kicking, and I was trying to get off stage, still kicking, still the professional, still
yes.
singing and kicking.
Yes.
I was spraying the audience.
Oh!
It was brilliant.
I literally got off stage and my understudy was laughing backstage. He'd put Ex-Lax.
No.
Yeah, which is a laxative in my drinking water. And I literally, my bowels emptied on stage in my pants, in my white polyester.
And the front row.
Still felt fabulous and the front row knew about it. That was really a shitty performance.
Can we get a silhouette of that?
I actually think that might be the worst thing I've ever heard.
Anyway, none of that has anything to do with the answer. In 1944, the US Office of Strategic Services, that's the sort of predecessor organisation to the CIA, produced this. And it's a simple sabotage field manual.
Oh.
And it's a guide to a range of different ways where you can undermine the enemy's... their economy, their morale, their military offensiveness, and so on. And it's fantastic in the scope of stuff in this rather narrow book, demolishing bridges, how to cause trouble, quarrels on public transport, that kind of thing. So here's how to sabotage a lavatory. So what you do is you saturate a sponge, OK, with a thick starch or sugar solution, right? You squeeze it tightly until it is a ball. You wrap it with string to keep it in the ball, and then you let it dry. Mm. And once it is dry, you remove the string and you flush it down the lavatory. The sponge will gradually expand back to its normal size and it will entirely plug the sewage system.
Oh, and why would you want to do that?
If you want to mess with your enemy, mess with their toilets.
Oh.
Yeah. I mean, it's really simple.
Just shit straight on their faces from the stage.
Exactly.
Cut out the middleman.
So some of the stuff they suggest, it's like schoolboy pranks in here.
Yeah.
But it's just stuff that the enemy would go, oh, now the toilets are backed up in the main office. It's just annoying. So let's try the lighting system in a factory. How would you sabotage the lighting system in a factory?
Cut a wire.
No, it's got to be more subtle than that, you see. So what you do is you turn the lights off, unscrew a light bulb, put a coin into the socket, put the light bulb back in again. As soon as somebody turns it on, the whole system will blow.
Because of the copper?
Yeah. I mean, it's...
I'm going to do that.
You don't, because they... it's
the electricians terrible. And plumbers back in the day would have been making an absolute killing.
Yeah, because you have to stick a coin in it.
This was a sponge, I was a coin. Yeah. He's charging 600 quid for the privilege.
What about the petrol tank of a vehicle?
Oh, that's sugar, isn't it?
You can do sugar or you can urinate in it.
Huh? Urine?
Yeah, just wee in it. I don't know why I'm giving all this away. Please don't do any of these things.
I've heard of them putting, like, a potato in the exhaust.
Yeah, I've heard of
them. I like this, the one in here that I think would only work in Britain. To start an argument on a train, if you work for the railway, issue two tickets for the same seat.
Ah, yes.
That's every day.
Yeah.
Yes.
Moving on. What use are shadows, anyway?
Oh, look at them.
It's nothing to do with music. It is everything to do with... What would you use a shadow for?
Discipline.
What?
Is that what they called the cane in your school? The shadow.
No, so...
You will see the shadow, my friend.
Oh, they come No. When I was about 6 or 7 years old, I used to go to mosque. And before we used to go for the evening prayers at sunset, we'd hang out in the park because we were cool young Muslim boys. And on one particular day, one of the kids said, the longer your shadow is, the more sin you've committed. So you're going to go to hell. And, of course, as the sun was setting, our shadows get longer, and you'd see 6 or 7 of us just running around trying to get the shadow as sure small as possible.
Then so sweet.
And then I found bacon, and so...
Yeah.
Maybe you could use your shadow to work out what time it is.
It is to do with timing. So I have here, for example, a pocket sundial, and if you raise up this little part here... you would be able to tell the time. I mean, you can just wear a watch is the other way of doing it.
Yeah.
But this is an old way of doing it, but it's got a compass and a shadow. The thing about this is it would give a very crude approximation of the time. The larger it is, the more accurate it's going to be. The one that possibly would give you the best time, 22.6 metres, that's about 75 foot high, Virat Samrat Yantra, it's the great king of instruments in Jaipur. It was completed in 1734, and it gives the time accurate to 2 seconds.
Wow.
I know, it's amazing. So the shadow moves at a millimetre per second. It's fast enough to see. I think that's incredible. And then the shadow of the even taller sundial bridge, that's over the Sacramento River in Redding in California, moves at 5 millimetres per second.
Wow.
It's a stunning thing.
That one, in Sacramento?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, it's in Redding, California. It's the Sacramento River. Smaller, but no less impressive, and I certainly would like one for the garden, were the sundial cannons. This is a sort of niche accessory from 17th to the 19th century. So it's a sundial with a magnifying glass positioned on it to concentrate the sun's rays at midday so that it would go down onto some gunpowder and fire a cannon. Who doesn't want one of those?
You wouldn't want to be standing in front of it.
Yes.
There was one in the Palais Royal in Paris. It used to go off at midday. People used to go and watch. And the only one remaining that's functioning is the sun cannon in Atvidaberg in Sweden. You can use shadows to power a digital watch. So the scientists at the University of Singapore have unveiled their shadow effect energy generator. And when it's completely in shadow or fully in light, it produces a very low amount of electricity or nothing at all. And it's the contrast between shadow and light that makes it work. And it generates enough current to power a digital watch. Why is it best to weigh yourself in the dark?
So you don't know how much you've eaten.
Well, I presume when you say better, you mean it gives you a lower reading.
It does. So light falling onto a surface exerts a tiny amount of pressure.
That's what it is.
I know, you would think. Wouldn't think. Yes.
Your bathroom's too bright.
A tiny amount of pressure. If you remove light from a surface, you remove that tiny amount of pressure. And this pressure can be used to power spacecraft. So, the Japanese Icaros is a spacecraft. It was launched in May 2010.
Icarus? That is not a spacecraft I'd get on.
It stands for the Interplanetary Kite Craft Accelerated by Radiation of the Sun.
Of course.
It's an acronym. It has a 46-foot square sail which uses light pressure plus the solar wind as its means of propulsion.
Wow.
I know.
It's amazing.
Because you only need a small amount of power. There's no resistance in space. So it's enough. And so we descend into the shadowy realm of shaky misunderstandings that we call general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. I'm looking forward to my summer holiday. How can I prepare to get a nice, deep suntan without burning?
Sun lotion? Would you not... Sunscreen?
Probably the very correct answer, my darling, yes. People used to think that the idea was to lay down a sort of base tan, possibly in a tanning salon or something, and it's a widespread thought, but it is entirely wrong. The only way you can protect yourself is with suntan lotion.
Or clothes.
Clothes. Mm. Or you and I would just sit in the shade, wouldn't we, Alan?
Drinking heavily.
So they wanted to demonstrate this, so they needed some skin that had zero exposure to the sun, so they chose British bottoms. Yeah. And they were exposed to simulated
they
sunlight.
Replicate conditions at the centre of the earth.
Can I just say what an awful representation of the United States of America that picture is?
Yeah. It's not pretty, is it?
No.
No. Would you or wouldn't you, Victoria?
I think he looks all right.
It's all right. Anyway. 2 weeks they spent with simulated sunlight on naked buttocks, and the resulting tan gave them a tiny bit of protection. Basically, it meant you could spend an extra 10 minutes in the sun. And tanning parlour sunbeds are really as bad, if not worse, than natural sunlight. Indeed, indoor tanning causes about 420,000 cases of skin cancer a year in the US alone.
What?
Yeah. If you go to an indoor tanning place and you think that's going to save you from getting skin cancer because you've got a base tan, probably it's going to exacerbate the chances of you getting skin cancer because you think you're safe, so you think you can lie out in the sun for a bit longer.
And I'm from Essex, so this is a good public service message.
Yes, darling, and you're the one who said suntan lotion.
Yeah,
so
I did.
Well done, you.
Thank you.
Now, why do you call it the dark side of the moon?
Oh, the cliffhangers, look at them.
Because it's the title of the album.
Which album, darling?
The Pink Floyd album.
OK, in the words of Pink Floyd, there is no... Dark side of the moon. The reason we can't see the far side of the moon is that the moon is tidally locked to the Earth. So let me show you.
Oh, I love a visual.
Oh. Okay. So here is the moon, and you can see that it is facing towards the Earth.
You can't see that arrow, can you? Because it, where we are on Earth, we just see the point of it, and it's invisible.
Yeah,
completely. But it is there.
So if you look at the moon, because of the way the moon orbits the Earth, we only ever see one side of it. But that doesn't mean that the unseen side is always dark, because the moon is orbiting the Earth and they are both orbiting the sun. So all the sides of the moon end up facing the sun at various times. There are bits of the moon which are in permanent darkness. There's a sort of crater of eternal darkness. It's a bit like the reason why La Cranza is Shady Town, where we started.
Crater of eternal darkness. I'm going to call my house that. Hello, crater of eternal darkness. Yes, we deliver.
Great name for a restaurant. There's a place called the Shackleton Crater. It's at the moon's south pole, and it receives no sunlight because it's so deep and so close to the pole. The opposite of this is the peak of eternal light, which is what I'm going to call my house, somewhere where there's always sunlight, and we haven't found that yet on the moon. Oddly enough, the rim of the Shackleton Crater gets pretty close. It's sunny 94% of the time, but the actual crater itself is not at all. Now, pause for thought. What happens to your pores in a sauna?
When they warm up, do they open up? And when it's cold, they close up?
Yep.
OK, so here's the thing. Pores allow us to sweat, and so that regulates body temperature. But they don't have muscles. They cannot open and close. So if you want to use warm water, for example, that cleans your pores. It doesn't change their size at all.
OK.
They do and can increase in size as you age, but it has nothing to do with your washing regime in any way.
I love watching videos on... No, not... That's another
key
story.
Key change!
You know how people watch, like, hear certain sounds and it soothes them and it calms them? Yeah. I watch videos of people popping. Yeah. Pimples.
What?
They're very popular.
And
I watch them too.
But why would you watch?
Why would you watch that?
I don't know. I don't understand it myself, but I found out just by one night going. I watched, there's a show called Dr. Pimple Popper.
Yes.
Oh my God.
I thought, I'm going to search this on YouTube. And oh my God, it's a whole community.
Do you never pick your spots or blackheads?
I don't have spots or blackheads. I'm 4,000 years old. The paws are always with us, sadly. Now, this is exciting. We've done a bit of research on who is in line for the throne. And we know the correct answer to this question. Which of you on this panel is closest to inheriting the crown?
I look good.
I think we all deserve a yas, queen.
Yas!
I love it. I'm a classy.
It must be Alan.
Wow.
Well, it must be. I explain how it's not Alan.
Here's the truth of it, it's none of us.
No, it can't be none of us. You said who's the closest.
Yeah.
Closest. No, we could all be far away.
Nobody.
But somebody... No.
Nobody.
No.
Most people think that we're all somehow in line to the throne eventually, even if you're number 52 million and 14 or whatever.
Yeah.
In fact, the list of succession is extremely limited. You have to be a direct descendant of Princess Sophia, Electress of Hanover. He was born in The Hague in 1630.
Oh, great Granny Sophia. That's where the family hair began.
It could be.
This was painted just a week after she shat on Hampstead Heath.
Do you not think it's weird that she looks surprised to be having her portrait done?
I like the look of her.
She's rather fine. She was the granddaughter of James I, so she was chosen as heir to the throne to ensure a Protestant lineage in the event that William or Queen Anne died without issue. And it was to block the old pretender James Stuart, who was a Catholic. Unfortunately, she died 2 months before she was due to take over, so we got her son, George I. And it's a shame, because she was extraordinary. She spoke 5 languages, she was educated in theology, history, mathematics, law. She was buried in the Burggarten Mausoleum in Hanover, and ironically, considering that all British royalty is descended from her, that was almost completely destroyed by Allied bombers during World War II.
Wow.
Buckingham Palace has never published a full record of Sophia's descendants, but 2 American men did a full investigation. And they both independently found that the last person in line to the throne, the 4,973rd, is a German pain therapist called Karen Vogel.
A German pain therapist?
Yeah.
Try typing that into Google.
I know.
Just go straight to images.
Which brings us to the scores. Looking distinctly shaky in last place with -7. It's Alan!
Thank you. Thank you.
Third place with -3, Victoria! Yay! Second with 1 point, John! Yes, Queen!
Yes, Queen!
But overshadowing everybody is tonight's winner with 5 points, Eshaan! Eshaan, John and Alan, I leave you with this shadowy sign-off from Chinese philosopher Lin Yutang. When small men begin to cast big shadows, it means that the sun is about to set. Good night. Good night.